Since the Spaniards' time, there have been horses here. Now, they have been taken away. But sometimes on foggy mornings, we hear them nickering. And sometimes from the long grasses below Boland's Bluff, a mare's gray mane will emerge. And, nudging at her underside, her chestnut colt, his quivering tail. We hear them because we are insatiable. We see them because we have finally learned how to walk where the horses are. Spikes of pickerel weeds swaying like girls in blue dresses. A distant oval of water. The thin logs of alligators in the water. A long white arrow of egrets. Oh, spirit of the prairie, grant me this moment. Add nothing, take nothing away. I'm walking under arched oaks whose draped scars are dreams I might have had when I was a child, before I had seen moss, when suddenly in a rush of wings, an osprey lands on the fence ahead. I breathe like a falling wing. A soft grass bowl of mist, three silent crows perched in a pine. Myself, Earth, these thousand years. In each of my fingers is another woman. The hairs on my head belonged to someone else. Their ends are split with their long history. Sometimes my feet carry me where Jane wanted to go, where Anne dreamed in her tower. I am Ellen, out of her century. The way girls bare their legs shames my thee-saying heart. When I speak, I hear harmonies I do not understand, but other ladies flow in me like blood. Their other lives swell the veins on the backs of my hands. Their stories scatter like black bees from my mouth and return to lie with me through the dangerous night. My dear, today we sold the last pig, and who knows when we shall get another. But collards crowd the garden, hurry into bloom faster than we can pick, and onions round as babies' heads swell daily. So much abundance have we here that every seed we plant springs eager from the ground, while I sit, for a moment alone, writing brown lines to a dead man. When I tell you, the children have not forgotten your name. My fingers scratch against the page like live things. and the mockingbird that has been all day singing in the trees stops. His wings rustle in the leaves. Then there is a dark settling and a quiet under the branches, and the light never comes. Frank will stand by me, his hand resting like a bird on my shoulder. I will be wearing my best poplin, which the camera will alter from blue to black. This is years from now. Or, Frank sits, I stand. There is only one child, a thin-faced girl. The ghosts of her brothers and sisters are looking over her shoulder. She does not see them, but I do. Stop, ghosts, I am telling them. But they titter and push to get into the picture. Frank is wax. His image and the child's are sharp. Mine is blurred. Behind me, white curtains blow, though afterwards we said we could not remember a day so still. Tornado weather, we said, but no tornado came. If I eat feathers, asks the child, will I be able to fly? You already can, says her mother. Any night, the lightness in you may lift you from your cot. That's why I close the windows. When I get old enough, the child wonders, will you open them? Oh yes, comes the answer, sorrowing. That's what mothers do. Each stroke parts the pollen that closes behind me. I rest my dripping paddle on my knees, and this river sloshes against my hull. Wonder why I ever wanted anything but this. Palms and tupelo raise candles to the light. Water lines mark the cypresses under which lily leaves swoop. So gracefully, they've no need to bloom. Overhead, indigo fox grapes dangle, all tiny tang and pit, from a confusion of overhanging moss. Near shore, pickerel weed backdrops water lettuce, and the yellow fists of spatterdock, its leaves unashamedly splayed. My kayak lurches, stills. Something huge, something thousands of years, is sheltering under me. In the dawn hush, my paddles sound like greed. I stop, float rocking. Soon the far shore turns rose and the water under my hull starts to gleam. And the sun lifts off her nest, casting a ladder of light across the water. I paddle toward it with all my arms. Hundreds of vultures cross the humming air to settle like black flowers in certain oaks. And now, as dusk deepens, they unfold their wings and, in a flash of benediction, disappear. Oh, my boy, I wish you had not already lived half your life. Thank you. rain blinks on the surface of the lake, and I see that it was always sky. A sudden arrowing lifts a brim to glory. This winter afternoon, I fear the reflection of your red canoe will slip slowly and without explanation out of sight. This is how we go forward, between limestone bluffs studded with small eaten grottos, their walls trembling with rivershine, between the live oaks that cling to landslid banks, up an aisle lined with cicadas that sing every moment they spend above ground, because they were so long below it, and will be again. Between cypresses whose knees know what is holy, dipping our paddles into the dark red water, resting them spread like wings, past sand curves with their litters of mussel shell and their raccoon tracks and their marks of otter tail and their squiggly lines just below the surface as of boys dragging sticks, past spinning clusters of whirligig beetles that taste like metal. Forward, though the beavers shun us as hard as they can. Forward, though the turtles do not desire us either. Past a side surge of a tiny bubbling spring. Despite the empty bottles and the stinking cans of fish bait and the shiny bits of discarded line, we lean our paddles out together. Despite the fact that the day will end, no matter what we want, to a kind of joy as we drag our kayaks up the mud amid clouds of yellow butterflies, the souls of those who drifted by thinking how effortless all this was, how light they seemed to themselves, like leaves. One May morning, I wake up, feeling as if it must be my birthday. I pull on my thick socks and boots and drive into town. Past the start of the Gainesville Hawthorne Trail at Boulware Springs, the road becomes a one-lane tunnel of live oaks and Spanish moss. It ends at the northern edge of Payne's Prairie, where I slip on my day pack and step from an unmarked corner of the parking lot into another world. My path twists and turns like a sleeper on a hot night. I try to walk like a Tomoquin, without weight. How often in our lives, I think, are our footsteps loud? But the moment I begin to revel in the almost total silence, exactly as if someone turned a knob, birds fade in, still singing, though it's already mid-morning. Now, suddenly, stoppingly, the trees on my right fall open like a box whose ribbons have dropped away, and a yellow and blue plane appears, at the same time intimately below me and fading into distance. A long flight of egrets rises and falls just over its watery surface. I step off the trail and stand still. I have squandered my life, the way a spoiled child tosses Christmas gifts aside, saying, "Doesn't matter, there are plenty." In a few moments, the live oak leaves over my head begin to gossip, as a little breeze arrives with rain in its hands. What follows sounds like wings, but maybe only the air turning pages. A raindrop hits a leaf high over my head, then another, and another, and another, and another. The rhythm's as irregular as a toddler's first experiments with a stick. All at once it's pouring. I can't get any wetter, so it can stop raining now, right? But of course it doesn't. That's what I love about Florida rain. It never drizzles like a frumpy aunt. Instead, it's the deluge of someone crossed in love. No one can say they're there to a Florida shower. There's too much noise, it's too far gone. It rains here the way I'd like to live. Fast and passionate. Even though I know it can't last. Especially because I know it can't last. But eventually, as they will, no matter what I want, the raindrops slow. Finally, there's just a drip, drip, drip of oaks and magnolia, spilling what they must have realized all along they couldn't keep. And steam rising everywhere as the earth breathes out. And I go on. The path dips and rises. To my left is a huge live oak studded with vines. Its arms reach to the ground tenderly, like a mother reaches to pick up a child. When my own children were young, they'd climb those vines and dangle by their knees until their faces turned red and they begged to be lifted down. We've come to Persimmon Point. I know there are wild horses here, so I kneel for twigs to build them a corral. This close to the ground, I notice something sticking up in a pocket gopher mound, like a chocolate stick in ice cream. When I pick it up, I see its edges have been chipped away. I am kin to the one who made it. I am kin.